Hey everybody, Tom Barnes, Chicago scene in the middle of Washington Square Park. Believe it or not, survived the Great Chicago Fire 150 years ago, became a tent city of sorts to house a bunch of Chicagoans that were displaced due to the fire, and a couple buildings survived this area, particularly a building that sits right at the doorstep that is now the Newberry Library. That is why they're going to have an event to commemorate 150 years since the Great Chicago Fire right here on Walton. And this beautiful park sits just south of it. I'm gonna talk to Paul about the history of the Great Chicago Fire and its historical significance of this very site for the Chicago scene. So let's wander over to the library and talk to Paul. All right, you're looking at the historical reading room on the second floor of the Newberry Library. I mean, many of Chicagoans have read books here, hung out here, talked here, and I bet you some of those topics are about the Great Chicago Fire. Paul, you're going to help me clear up some things with the Chicago Fire. 150 years, though, it's been coming this October 8th, right?
That's right, yes. October 8th marks the 150th anniversary of the Great Chicago Fire. And here at the Newberry, we're going to be commemorating that event with a free outdoor public program called Through the Flames and Beyond. And Through the Flames and Beyond tells the story of the fire and how it connects to the history of the library. So one of the only structures to survive the Great Chicago Fire that was within the path of the flames itself was a house that belonged to a guy named Malin Ogden.
Yeah, and that's kind of a big significant name in Chicago history, right?
A lot of people probably recognize the Ogden name, right?
Sure.
There's like an Ogden
or Avenue,
school,
right?
Or Ogden Avenue. Most people know his brother better. His brother William was the first mayor of the city of Chicago, and it was because of his brother that Malin ended up here. He was an attorney, but he dabbled in railroads and real estate, and he built a very nice house on what was then Lafayette Place, but today is Walton, between Clark and Dearborn. And when the Great Chicago Fire sort of, you know, tore through the city on October 8th and October 9th, it basically laid waste to the entire north side of Chicago. But when the flames went out, there was one house still standing. There were a couple others, but there was one house, prominent house still standing, and that was the house that belonged to Malin Ogden. And the reason that it survived is that it, like, some family friends and the family servants had enough presence of mind to take every scrap of cloth in the house, right? So like every bed linen, every curtain, every drape, carpets, rugs, soak them in water. And when the water ran out, they soaked them in cider that they had in the cellar and then wrapped the entire exterior of the house, basically kind of like wrapped it up like a mummy, so that when there were any sort of stray sparks or debris that got close to the house, they didn't happen to catch. And that's how the house was able to survive. And for a while became something of a tourist attraction as this sort of a relic of the fire.
That's an unbelievable story, just that they had the forethought to do that. As the city around them is burning and people are running out, they're doing that and saving it. And it effectively did save it, and right in front of the park here. And like you said, it became a little bit of a tourist attraction as the city started to rebuild, even the tent city that was across the way there. But, and that's why you're doing it outside there, right? And that's where you're going to have a bunch of things happening for this event.
So on October 8th, the event starts at 6:30 p.m., and what we're going to do is we're going to tell the story of how the Ogden Mansion was saved using the form of a 19th century magic lantern slideshow. So we're going to have new slides illustrated by a woman named Kathleen Judge, who's a really great artist. We're going to have like live music conducted by a man named Jeffrey Thomas. We're going to have some narration, and we're also going to have some historians on hand who are going to kind of break into the story to tell us a little bit more about how the fire connects to the Newberry. So we've got a lot of material related to the Great Chicago Fire here at the library, a lot of first-person accounts, a lot of photographs, a lot of stereoscopic cards, including some that had belonged to the poet Carl Sandburg, all of these maps. So lots of things for people to see here connected to the Great Chicago Fire.
And one of the things that we were talking about before we started this up was that there's this misconception that the Great Chicago Fire burned the entire city down. And that's just not 100% true, right? Why don't you clear that up for me?
Yeah, well, I mean, as someone who lives on you know, the south side of the city today, I can tell you this.
So, which they always seem to always be secondary, right? North side, south side, all the time, right?
Right, and the south side and the west side, you know, actually played a major part in helping the city rebuild. So, you know, back in October of 1871, the fire starts around what was DeCoven Street and a little bit north of Roosevelt, and then kind of sweeps like north and east, and eventually gets all the way up to Fullerton. Mm-hmm. But the fire only, you know, as I said, went down to about Taylor or Roosevelt, and it only actually ended up going about as far west as Jefferson. And at that time in 1871, the city's western boundaries actually extended as far as what is today Pulaski. So a lot of the west side was unimpacted. And then the city's south side boundaries went as far south as 39th Street or Pershing. And then, you know, there were a lot of communities that were then suburbs that would later get incorporated into the city that already existed, places like Hyde Park, for example. So, you know, after the fire, these communities were in place. They were able to take in a lot of the people who had lost their homes. About 100,000 Chicagoans out of a population of around 300,000 wow. lost their houses.
That's incredible.
As a result of the fire. They were able to, like, take a lot of these people in. City government moved to a church that was on the near west side for a time being. And then a lot of the industry was, you know, concentrated in these parts of the city. Like, the Union Stockyards were already there, right, in 1871. The railroads all existed. So Chicago was able to rebuild as quickly as it could because it wasn't entirely destroyed and because its transportation networks were still largely in place.
And you said that, you know, this is in October, so there was 100,000 people displaced right ahead of winter. But like you were saying, that Chicago acted quickly in building temporary housing that turned into a little bit longer, just because anything that's temporary when there's a disaster probably always sticks around longer than people anticipate. But those were scattered throughout the city as well.
Right, that's right. So, I mean, in the immediate aftermath of the fire, like, people from all around the country, communities from all around the country were, you know, very generous and very quick in their response. So donations were coming from Milwaukee, St. Louis, Cleveland, Detroit, you know, all the sort of regional cities, but also, you know, from East Coast and West Coast cities, and then even from around the world. Great Britain, England sent a lot of aid as well. And so the city was able to take all of these resources and direct some of them towards creating temporary housing. You know, single family homes for a select number of Chicagoans were built of various sizes, depending on how big your family were or was. And then there were also some kind of military style barracks as well for people who were impacted by the fire. And that helped people get through the winter. But by 1872, the city was well on its way to being rebuilt. And, you know, within less than, you know, 30 years, less than 25 years of the fire, Chicago's ready to host the 1893 World's Columbian Exposition, where the city really kind of emerges on the global stage. And by that point, you know, it's been more or less completely restored.
Right. And this very building that we're standing in was built and opened that very year, right?
That's right. Yeah. So
first full circle there, Paul.
Right. Yeah. I mean, so, you know, and it's interesting, too, when you look at how Chicago regards the Great Fire. So during the time of the World's Fair, October 9th was called Chicago Day down in Jackson Park, where the World's Fair was. And that was the day to celebrate the city, and they deliberately timed it so it would coincide with the anniversary of the fire. And if you got a ticket to go there, you got a ticket that had a little image of the mythical creature, the phoenix, on it, because that was a bird that, you know, famously would die in the flames but then rise up anew, right, and be reborn from the flames. And that's how Chicago regarded itself at the time, as the Phoenix City. And 750,000 people paid admission to go to the World's Fair on that day, Chicago Day, to kind of celebrate, you know, all things related to this city. And to keep in mind, the city's population at that time was only a little over a million, so that's a lot of folks. And what people reading the Tribune would have gotten that day is a nice color lithograph of the Malin D. Ogden Mansion, one of the survivors of the fire. But one thing they couldn't do is actually come here and see the Ogden House, because by that time it had been removed and the Newberry Library had been built up in its place.
And that's where we're standing right now, and that's where we're going to celebrate Chicago's perseverance through those 150 years and commemorate that actual event. Where can people go to find more information and to learn about the Chicago Fire and the history that you guys here have at the library?
Well, if you go to newberry.org, you'll learn about the event on October 8th, which is a free public event that starts at 6:30, and you'll also be able to look at the other resources that we have connected to the Great Chicago Fire.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your time today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, there you have it, the commemoration of 150 years since the Great Chicago Fire. TBARNAS at WGNTV.com. If you have a suggestion for the Chicago scene, that's TBARNAS at WGNTV.com. Until then, thanks for watching, everybody. See ya.